It's the morning of May 12th, 2017. Nothing seems out of the ordinary as you wake up and start your day. That is, until you go to turn on your computer and are greeted with this. You find a prompt from a program called WannaDecryptor informing you that all of your data has been encrypted, with the decryption keys being held for ransom. If you want your data back, you have 3 days to pay the initial ransom of $300, at which point you'll be raised to $600. If no payments are made after a week, your files will be permanently lost. You just became one of the first victims of a worldwide cyberattack known as WannaCry. Amid the panic, unbeknownst to you, WannaCry just spread to all the other devices on your network. After infecting a computer, it enacts a fully autonomous, self-replicating mechanism that enables it to silently spread across networks without requiring any user interaction. This makes it a computer worm, which by design will self-multiply and propagate itself at an exponential rate. At 7:44 UTC, the first case was identified at a Southeast Asian ISP. Shortly after, cases were starting to be identified globally. A mere 5 hours after the first case, 72% of ISPs in Asia were infected. Despite the discovery of a kill switch by a British security researcher, the damage was already done. Within a single day, over 230,000 computers across 150 different countries were infected, with damages ranging from hundreds of millions to billions of dollars. The National Health Service in the UK was among the largest agencies struck, with up to 70,000 devices affected. Certain locations had to turn away emergency patients, and various ambulances had to be diverted to other hospitals. In December 2017, the United States formally asserted that North Korea was behind the attack, later indicting three North Korean officials. North Korea denied any involvement.
As laid out in today's indictment, North Korea's operatives, using keyboards rather than guns, stealing digital wallets of cryptocurrency instead of sacks of cash, have become the world's leading bank robbers.
As the chaos was settling, about a month after the WannaCry outbreak, a series of powerful cyber attacks using the NotPetya malware were unleashed during the 2017 Ukraine ransomware attacks. Although it was mistaken for ransomware at first, it was quickly realized to be a disk wiper, designed to cause maximum damage to its targets. Despite only having a single day to spread, damages were estimated to be over $10 billion, becoming one of the most devastating cyber attacks in history. The United States claimed Russia was behind the attack, indicting a total of six Russian officials. Russia denied any involvement. In the coming months, several other cyber attacks arose globally. The United States continued to make indictments. Something seemed to be tying these together. Why were the most severe cyber attacks in history suddenly happening all at once? And just as importantly, why were they all computer worms? It turns out that they were all using the same exploit, EternalBlue. Surprisingly, EternalBlue was developed by the National Security Agency, a branch of the United States Department of Defense. Within the NSA, the specific unit is known as the Equation Group, a threat actor Kaspersky describes as surpassing anything known in terms of complexity and sophistication of techniques. Several years prior to the attacks, EternalBlue was developed as part of a collection of exploits, known as the Eternal Exploits, which targeted Microsoft's SMB V1 protocol. SMB, or Server Message Block, is one of the most widely used communication protocols in the world. It is primarily used for file sharing and print services on Windows computers and servers, among other devices. A vulnerability in SMB lends itself perfectly to a computer worm, as it is already extensively used across home and enterprise networks, with port 445 left open for legitimate SMB traffic. On top of this, it was enabled on systems by default at the time. The NSA, rather than informing Microsoft about the vulnerabilities, decided to keep them under wraps for several years. This was until the NSA themselves were hacked by a group called the Shadow Brokers in 2016. The Shadow Brokers stole a collection of exploits from the NSA and attempted to auction them off online. Unsure of the legitimacy of such claims, there were no bids. When the NSA realized that they were breached, they ended up informing Microsoft, who released a patch on March 14th, 2017. A month later, on April 14th, the shadow brokers decided to publicly release the exploits free of charge. The dump included the infamous EternalBlue exploit, alongside the rest of the Eternal exploits, an exploitation framework, a command and control solution, and a backdoor implant for use after an initial exploitation. With all these exploits and tools now publicly available, various threat actors began to incorporate them into their own malware. Not even a month later, WannaCry took hold of the world. Despite a patch technically being released 2 months prior, the countless number of individuals and organizations that don't regularly update their OS were left exposed. Now that we understand the source and significance of EternalBlue, let's take a look under the hood and see how it's actually able to fully compromise a remote system without any user interaction. Rather than being a single exploit, EternalBlue is an exploit chain, leveraging three different underlying bugs. The first two bugs work together to induce a buffer overflow, while the third bug enables us to force a memory allocation of arbitrary size. While these bugs may seem obscure in isolation, they all come together in the end, during the exploitation phase, using a technique known as heap grooming, or as I like to call it, heap feng shui. What makes EternalBlue especially impressive is that it injects its chosen payload directly into SMB's memory space, running entirely within the SMB process on the target machine. This makes it exceedingly difficult to detect, as it doesn't create any new processes. But I digress. To understand the exact mechanics at the heart of EternalBlue, let's start by taking a look at the SMB protocol. Similar to other protocols, communication within SMB takes the form of requests and responses being exchanged between two devices. The specific unit of information being exchanged is called an SMB message, also referred to as an SMB packet. These packets are divisible into three parts, being the header block, parameter block, and data block. The header block contains a field for the SMB command, which is used to specify the type of operation, such as creating, reading, or deleting a file. When dealing with operations pertaining to files, you may encounter the case where extended file attributes, or FFIs, are used. A FFI is just a way to store metadata associated with a file beyond the standard attributes defined by the file system itself. Each FFI takes the form of a key-value pair alongside their respective sizes. The exact implementation and format of these key-value pairs varies by operating system. For instance, OS2 and the Windows NT family have different FFI formats. Since SMB is compatible across different operating systems, it's possible to get into a case where OS2 formatted FFIs need to be cast to NT formatted FFIs. The first bug that EternalBlue exploits is the wrong casting bug, where a buggy casting operation is used to cast OS2 FFIs to NT FFIs, which causes a buffer overflow in the non-paged kernel pool. Just as an aside, the non-paged pool is just a memory pool that is designated to remain on the physical RAM. This is opposed to the paged pool, which can spill over from the physical RAM onto a slower page file on the disk. But I digress. In order to see how this buggy casting operation is able to cause a buffer overflow, we first need to understand how these FFIs are represented in code. OS2 FFIs actually require the use of two structures. Each individual FFI is represented with an OS2 FFI structure. Multiple of these are stored together using an OS2 FFI list, which combines them all together and stores the total size of the list in bytes. NT FFIs, on the other hand, use a structure called NT FFI list, which are chained together back-to-back in memory. This approach is known as an offset-based linked list. Each instance represents a single FFI, with the next entry offset field being used to tell where the next instance is located in memory relative to the current one. To navigate the nodes in the list, you would keep on adding the offset to the current node's memory address until you reach the end. Now that we know how these two different types of FFIs are represented, let's see what happens when we get into the case where we need to cast an OS2 FFI list to an NT FFI list. The serve OS2 FFI list to NT function will be used. Let's take a look inside. Just to be clear, the purpose of this function is to create an NT FFI list given an OS2 FFI list. In order to do this, we first need to determine the appropriate size for the soon-to-be-created NT FFI list, which is done with the serve OS2 FFI list size to NT helper function. Then, we'll use the size that this function returns to allocate a buffer in the non-paged pool for the new NTFeeList. Once the allocation is made, the last step is to convert and add the individual fees from the OS2 feeList to the NTFeeList. This is done by iterating over the individual OS2 feeList entries until it reaches size of list in bytes. Within each iteration, it converts the OS2 record to the NT format and adds it to the NTFeeList. It's important to note that the size of list in bytes field is used to determine how much underlying data is transferred into the NTFeeList. Now that we know that there's three different steps, let's go ahead and look at them in more detail, starting with the serve OS2 feeList size to NT function. This function actually does two distinct things. First, it calculates the size needed for the NTFeeList. This is the return value of the function, which is used to allocate the buffer, as we just saw. The second thing it's going to do will only happen on a specific edge case, in response to a malformed SMB packet. Because the size of list in bytes field doesn't actually restrict the SMB packet size, it's possible to carefully craft a packet with some amount of fees that actually extend past whatever value is set as the size of list in bytes. This would be a malformed packet. Why the function doesn't just drop these malformed packets is anyone's guess. Instead, what it does is it shrinks the size of list in bytes value down to the nearest inbounds fee. This new value that it calculates overwrites the original size of list in bytes value. Even though this may seem like weird behavior, it's not inherently dangerous. Some fees may be lost during the casting process, but that's about it. So, where exactly does this bug lie? Recall that under normal circumstances, with an intact SMB packet, nothing is modified. Only with a specific edge case with overflowing fees will size of list in bytes be shrunk. Let's take a look at how it is shrunk. Basically, size of list in bytes is defined as a ulong, which takes up the size of a dword. This is a 4-byte value. The function that's run to overwrite the size treats it as a ushort, which takes up the size of a word. This is a 2-byte value. This mismatch is the basis of the first bug. This means that if shrinking is needed, the two least significant bytes will be modified, while the two most significant bytes will remain untouched, due to the fact that the function treats a 4-byte dword as a 2-byte word. This means that if size of list in bytes is less than 2 to the 16, meaning it fits entirely within the range of the two rightmost bytes, known as the low dword, it will be shrunk as expected. However, if it is greater than 2 to the 16, and spans both the high dword and low dword, the function will only affect the low dword, leaving the high dword intact. Because of this, depending on the exact value being used, size of list in bytes may be enlarged instead of shrunk. Let's see how much damage this can actually cause. Zooming back out to our casting process at a high level, recall that the last step in the casting process will iterate over each OS2 fee in the OS2 fee list, converting and appending it to the NT fee list until it reaches size of list in bytes. Everything contained within this area is set to be copied over into the NTFeeList buffer. When creating this carefully crafted packet, the size of list in bytes field is going to be set to a controlled value larger than 2 to the 16, in hopes of triggering the bug that mistakenly enlarges it. Due to the enlargement of this field, the area to be copied over is increased. Throughout this entire process, up until this point, I left out a key piece of information about this specially crafted packet. When we created this packet, we actually would have placed some unrelated, attacker-chosen data directly following the feeList. Keep in mind that despite the size of list in bytes being wrongfully enlarged, the size for the newly created NTFeeList buffer is calculated correctly. Because of the enlarged value of size of list in bytes, the area to be copied over is now larger than the NTFeeList buffer size itself, meaning more data will be copied over than can fit within the buffer. This is known as an out-of-bounds write. In addition to all of the fees being copied over, the arbitrary data that we included within our malformed packet will also be copied over as well, so long as it fits within the area marked by size of list in bytes. In short, bug A achieves an out-of-bounds write of arbitrary data past the bounds of the NTFeeList buffer, which resides within the non-paged kernel pool. The important takeaway here is that if there was anything else directly following the NTFeeList buffer in memory, it would be overwritten with this attacker-injected data. Keep this in mind for later in the attack. So far, this makes sense. However, you might have been wondering exactly why a field defined as a U long is treated as a U short. It's actually bug B that makes this happen. You need both bug A and B to pull off this out-of-bounds write successfully. Within SMB, there are several commands that can be used for file-related operations. SMBcom transaction2 and SMBcom nttransact are two relevant examples of such commands. If the amount of data that needs to be transmitted exceeds the maximum within a single SMB packet, it may be broken up into multiple packets. Each command has a corresponding subcommand ending in underscore secondary, which makes it possible to send two packets back to back, with the secondary packet containing the remaining data that couldn't fit within the primary packet. It's important to note that the trans2 request defines its fields in word sizes, whereas the nttrans request defines its fields in dword sizes. Bear with me on this. There is no validation enforcing that multipart transactions must be of the same type, meaning it's possible to send mismatching primary and secondary commands. What we're going to do is send an nttrans followed by a trans2 secondary, which will be treated and parsed as a valid two-part transaction. Even though this will be accepted as a valid transaction, we know that these two transaction types will use different field sizes. The fault in SMB is that it doesn't take into account that different transaction types may be used together, despite having different field sizes. As a result, the field size of the last transaction type will be used for parsing all of the packets. This means that the primary nttrans packet that uses dword sizes will be treated as if it only uses word sizes, which is what causes the incorrect parsing function to be used, as we saw in bug A. Just to recap, bugs A and B work together to enable an out-of-bounds write past the boundary of the NT field, injecting arbitrary data into the subsequent memory locations within the non-paged kernel pool. If you're like me, you've probably been hearing the term buffer overflow thrown around for quite some time. Despite being frequently discussed and widely recognized as a severe vulnerability, buffer overflows on their own are rarely enough to compromise a system. Just because an attacker is able to trigger a bug doesn't mean that they're able to use it for anything useful. How would the attacker even know what data lies outside of the buffer? There's a wide variety of buffer overflow protection and mitigation techniques standing in their way, such as address space layout randomization, which breaks address space predictability, and data execution prevention, which marks certain memory regions as non-executable. EternalBlue pairs this buffer overflow with more sophisticated techniques, which we'll see shortly. When I was researching for this video, I came across this DEFCON presentation by ZeroSum0x0, which was invaluable in understanding the types of techniques you might see at this level. Understanding these attacks often requires a strong foundation of knowledge and understanding, combined with effective problem-solving skills. This is where today's video sponsor comes in, Brilliant. With Brilliant, you learn by doing, engaging with thousands of interactive lessons in math, programming, computer science, data science, and AI. Brilliant offers lessons that are designed to instill proper principles and teach you fundamentals from the ground up in a hands-on environment. All content on Brilliant is crafted by an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from schools such as MIT and Caltech, and even industry partners such as Google and Microsoft. All of their lessons are filled with hands-on exercises that let you play with concepts in real time, a method proven to be more effective than simply watching lecture videos. Brilliant helps to build real-world critical thinking skills through problem-solving, not memorizing. So while you're building real knowledge on specific topics, you'll also be becoming a better thinker. The best part, you don't need to dedicate hours at a time to learning. Developing a daily habit of learning is going to keep your mind sharp and your information diet rich, which is invaluable for both personal and professional growth. That's why Brilliant provides its lessons in manageable, bite-sized pieces that can be done whenever, wherever, helping you build real knowledge in just minutes a day. Personally, I replaced a lot of my social media scrolling with Brilliant, and I wouldn't look back. You can start to learn the core mechanics powering the everyday technologies we all know and love, such as search engines, neural networks, cryptocurrency, or even quantum computing. Most recently, I took their course on large language models, which gives you hands-on experience with real language models. You get to explore the impact that training data has on the model's output, and even spend some time learning how to tune an LLM to become better suited toward a specific task. This is increasingly relevant to the age of AI assistance, and with the rise of adversarial machine learning attacks. A robust set of problem-solving skills and a wide breadth of knowledge are often key in being able to spot patterns and piece together solutions in the world of cybersecurity. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/DanielBachter or click the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. This concludes part 1 of this 2-part series. To continue with the series, check out part 2, which will be available here once it's released. Thanks for watching.